So we have done this question and this propionic pathway. And this is the same pathway showing molecular structure. You can understand from this pathway. So three carbon is there, and three carbon compound propionyl coenzyme A will convert into four carbon methyl malonyl. You can see this methyl malonyl as a little bit of branch type of compound. This is CO, this is malonic acid. So this type of compound, this is CH3. So this is a methyl malonyl coenzyme A. It will convert into acid. So biotin and vitamin B12 are required. That is why this is very important. In biotin deficiency, you will see high propionic acid. In this vitamin B12 deficiency, you will see high methyl malonic acid. So you will, and that is why this pathway is very important. Now let's talk about this gluconeogenesis that happens from individual component. Now you can see the glycerol phosphate. It will be produced from lipolysis, from glycerol. Triglyceride will be formed in adipose tissue. Then when it converts into glycerol phosphate, it will convert into glycerol 3 phosphate. This will be oxidized. This will be oxidized because glycerol is 3OOH at 3 position like this. So this is glycerol and this will be oxidized, and there will be formation of this double bond. This is glyceraldehyde. So this glyceraldehyde dihydroxyacetone phosphate will form here. Double bond O will form, and this hydrogen will be released from this. This will produce this. So from glycerol 3 phosphate, dihydroxyacetone phosphate will form, and from this dihydroxyacetone phosphate there will be production of glucose. And you see this glycerol phosphate is also derived from this dihydroxyacetone phosphate. So either way, you can see the reaction. Glycerol phosphate during lipogenesis is, our body gets glycerol phosphate during lipogenesis from this compound, dihydroxyacetone phosphate, DHAP, dihydroxyacetone phosphate. So how does this convert? Dihydroxyacetone phosphate, you know, it is an intermediate of glycolysis. So what will happen is this so this glycerol dihydroxyacetone phosphate, this will also convert into, there will be two dihydroxyacetone phosphate, one dihydroxyacetone phosphate, and this other dihydroxyacetone phosphate will convert into what? Glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate. So this glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate and this, they will join to form fructose 2,6-bisphosphate. One 6-bisphosphate. And this is catalyzed by enzyme called aldolase. Aldolase is a reversible reaction. So that is opposite reaction that happens during glycolysis. Glycolysis, from this it will be synthesized. Now this, from this fructose 1,6-bisphosphate will convert into what? This fructose 1,6-bisphosphate, through irreversible reaction, it will convert into, by action of fructose 1,6-bisphosphatase, it will convert into fructose 1-phosphate. Then this fructose 1-phosphate will convert into by reversible reaction, it will convert into glucose. This is not 1-phosphate, this is 6-phosphate. 1 is released, 6-phosphate. Now this glucose, fructose 6-phosphate will convert into glucose 6-phosphate. And then this glucose 6-phosphate, by action of glucose 6-phosphatase, it will convert into glucose. So this is how this glycerol 3-phosphate from lipid will convert into glucose. through reverse process of glycolysis. And this whole process occurs inside cytosol only. It does not, there is no incorporation utilization of mitochondrial matrix. There is no reaction in when conversion of this glycerol-3-phosphate to dihydroxyacetone phosphate happens. There is no any reaction that happens inside mitochondria. Now let's see other. You can see, so I have already told you gluconeogenesis is uphill process. So it is uphill process in comparison to this glycolysis. It is a downhill process. So glycolysis, what will happen? The glucose will convert into pyruvate, but in gluconeogenesis, this pyruvate will convert into glucose. If it is an uphill process, there should be utilization of some ATP. And how many ATP are utilized for one glucose synthesis? If you start from pyruvate, how many ATP is utilized? Can anybody tell me? How many ATP is utilized?
Four.
How many?
Two.
Is it two? Devi Lola?
Six.
So minus six. First tell me, how many ATP is produced?
Produced, I think.
Glycolysis. Don't talk, let's not talk about how many ATP is produced completely. No, I'm not talking about net. I'm talking about gross ATP produced.
From glucose.
How many ATP is produced here through this glycolysis?
Eight.
Is it when you take this NADH as 2.5 NADH as 2.5 ATP? So Divya, forget about old what you have studied, that one NADH is equal to 3 ATP. Okay, you have to study 2.5 ATP. Okay, so in that, if you consider this one NADH is equal to 2.5 ATP, how many ATP will be produced? Come,
7.
Include all ATP. I'm not talking about net ATP. Net ATP is 7. So what are the steps? At glycerol dehyde 1 phosphate, how many ATP is produced?
9.
When glycerol dehyde 3 phosphate converts into glycerate? 2 ATP?
2 ATP.
Okay. At pyruvate kinase step,
how 2 many ATP steps? Again.
2 ATPs.
2 ATP. And then at NADH production, when this
2 NADH
again, 2 NADH means,
so 5 ATP
would be 5 ATPs then.
So how many ATP production?
Nine.
Completely
9
ATP. We subtract, that is why we subtract 2 that is consumed in 2 steps, and that is why it is 7. The gross production is 9. Now see, when you see the opposite process, the places where you see in glycolysis consumption of ATP at first step and second step and third step, there will not be production of ATP. I'll show you pathway. Can you see this pathway? Glycolysis, yeah. Site?
Yes.
And gluconeogenesis, this site? So let me write glycolysis. Glycolysis. So you have calculated how many ATP? 9 ATP. Production. Total 9 ATP, actually production. So there should be consumption of 9 ATP. You can see there will be consumption of 2 NADH. NADH. There will be consumption of 2 NADH where, when this glycerate converts into glycerol dehyde. There will be consumption of 2 NADH. Did you get this?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
2, 2. And then 2 ATP production when this phosphoglycerate 2, 3. I am not writing very completely, just remember, understand the concept. When this 2, 3 phosphoglycerate, 1, 3 bisphosphoglycerate, when convert into glycerate, 3-phospho, then there has been production of 1 ATP. And this is a reversible reaction. So you can see this here, there will be utilization ATP. So 2 ATP will be utilized here. Now let's talk about this PP, phosphoenol pyruvate. Now from when pyruvate converts into phosphoenol pyruvate, how many ATP is being utilized? You can see consumption of 2 ATP here and consumption of 2 ATP here also. So total 4 ATP. Can you see here? But in glycolysis, the reverse reaction, here only production of 2 ATP was there. Here consumption of 4 ATP. So 4 plus 2, how many? 6. 6 plus 5. How many?
11.
Yes. So total ATP consumed is 11 ATP. So you can understand from glycolysis, because glycolysis, whatever produced glycolysis, that much ATP will be consumed. But there is one more step here. And that is why 9 plus 2 is 11. 11 ATP is consumed. Did you understand how many ATP, how 11 ATP is consumed?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So you see, the gluconeogenesis is a process of synthesis of glucose from non-carbohydrate sources. Glucose can be synthesized from glycerol 3-phosphate from lipid. After all, what is the contribution of fatty acid? So contribution of fatty acid from triglyceride, you know, this can convert into glucose. But during gluconeogenesis, this fatty acid will contribute for what? ATP. And this ATP, you know, 11 ATP is required for synthesis of 1 glucose. 11 ATP is required for synthesis of 1 glucose. Now, how many ATPs are required for conversion of pyruvate to glucose? You already know, don't you know? How many ATP? Now you can easily understand. I don't have to repeat it again. So you can you see 11 ATP from new convention. If you take 1 NADH is equal to 3 ATP, there will be 12. So you can see 2 ATP consumption at this stage, 2 ATP consumption in the form of GTP here, and then 2 ATP, 3 phosphoglycerate kinase. When this 3-phosphoglycerate kinase will convert into here, about here, at this step 2, and then glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate dehydrogenase will utilize this 2 NADH. So total, if you calculate, it becomes 11 ATP. Did you understand? So I assume that you know glycolysis. Yes, tell me.
Said yes.
Yes,
sir.
Yes, you understood. Okay, thank you. Okay. So if you don't understand, let me know. I will draw that whole pathway. If you don't understand, if you understand, that's okay. Let me draw the pyruvate to oxaloacetate to phosphoenol pyruvate. You can see this is done by pyruvate carboxylase, pyruvate carboxy kinase, 2-ATP here, 2-ATP here. Now this phosphoenol pyruvate will convert into what? It will convert into what? 3-phosphoglycerate. Okay, then this 3-phosphoglycerate will convert into, it will utilize, this is a reversible, these are reversible process. These two are irreversible process. These are reversible process. Now this 3-phosphoglycerate will convert into 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate, utilize 2-ATP. Now this 3-phosphoglycerate will convert into glycerate, will convert into glyceraldehyde. This is reversible reaction. So there will be consumption of NADH. So 3-phospho, rather than writing this, glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. 3-phosphate, and a part of this glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate can convert into dihydroxyacetone phosphate by trias isomerase, and this will combine to form fructose 1,6-bisphosphate, and then through irreversible reaction, release of phosphate, this is catalyzed by fructose 1,6-phosphatase, bisphosphatase, then fructose 6-phosphate, and then what else? This is a reversible reaction by isomerase, glucose 6-phosphate isomerase will do conversion of fructose 6-phosphate to phosphohexoisomerase. Will convert fructose to glucose 6-phosphate, glucose 6-phosphate to this. This is a reversible reaction. Again, this irreversible reaction will catalyze glucose 6-phosphatase and then production of what? Glucose. So this is the reaction. You can see 2-ATP, 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 4, 2 plus 2, plus 2, 6, 6 plus 5 is 11 ATP. So you understood whole process. I have revised it. So if somebody don't understand and don't want to speak, then you will, they will also understand. Why is preterm infant are more prone to, you know, the infant that is born before the date of delivery are more prone to hypoglycemia. Why? The newborn are also a bit prone to hypoglycemia in comparison to grown baby, because these are the two reasons. There are limited substrate storage for gluconeogenesis, okay? Because proteins are very less and fat is also very less. That is why limited storage substrate are stored in the body of a baby for proteins in glucose synthesis. One reason. Second is immaturely developed gluconeogenesis and pathway, regulating glucose turnover. So enzymes are also not that well developed. So both are the reason. That is why you have to feed newborn baby or preterm baby frequently. So this is the reason I have mentioned this. So what is the cause of alcohol hangover and how it is treated? So what is the cause of alcohol hangover? Now you can see here in alcohol use, what happens is this NADH is increased in very high concentration because ethanol will convert into acetaldehyde and there will be formation of NADH, and then again the second step, what will this acetaldehyde will convert into acetic acid, again production of NADH. So this ethanol metabolism will release, will produce so many, so high concentration of NADH, and this will be utilized. That is why this become less and this will become very high. NADH will become very high. If NADH becomes very high, what does it do? It will inhibit whole glycolytic path. That is utilized for even for gluconeogenesis. If this glycolytic, this Krebs cycle is inhibited, what will happen? The production of glucose will also be affected. And second is that this pyruvate that is converted, that the body gets from this alanine or other amino acid will convert into lactate. So you can see from this way, the high NADH will inhibit gluconeogenesis. As you can see, high NADH will inhibit gluconeogenesis. That is why if gluconeogenesis is inhibited, what will happen? There will be a heaviness in head. Heavy head. The heavy head will have like you will feel something missing. Something like heaviness in your head. And that is hangover, isn't it? Hangover?
Isn't yes, sir. Hangover?
So if you have hangover because of alcohol intake, what do you do? How do you treat this?
No, they give them coffee.
Eat coffee. That is also a good idea. Eat coffee. Take glucose or fructose rich diet. So these are the, if you supplement glucose level, then you will have, you will recover from alcohol. Better not to take alcohol that much. So fruit juice can be used to treat the problem. So because in liver, this fructose metabolism is very rapid. It does not go through glycolysis. Fructose has its own glycolysis and fruit juice has fructose. And I have told you this, the fructose has two enzymes, specific enzyme. One is fructokinase and second enzyme is aldolase B. And that will directly convert this fructose into glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. And this glyceraldehyde will easily convert into glucose also. So you can use this fructose to treat this patient. So this is how fructose can convert into glucose through gluconeogenesis. When a person is in hangover. Did you understand the significance of fructose metabolism that is helpful for when the pathway is inhibited? Actually, what I want to say, when pathway, I'm giving you a very different context of alcohol intake so that you will understand the pathway better. So did you understand this? No. So fructose, specific enzyme for fructose metabolism, fructokinase and aldolase, which will convert it into directly into glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate and glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate through this opposite of glycolysis, it will convert into glucose. Like as glycerol 3-phosphate converts into glucose, the same way glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate will convert into glucose. Now, so let's talk about regulation of this gluconeogenesis. So do you know how gluconeogenesis is regulated?
Hormonal regulation.
Yes, it's great. Hormonal regulation. Regulation. One is hormonal regulation. How hormonal regulation? How does a hormone regulate?
When there is low glucose in the blood, so the hormone acts for the breakdown of glucose.
How does a hormone influence that? How I want to ask you, how does this hormone regulate enzyme? Which method? Through which method?
Feedback.
Three method of enzyme regulation.
Feedback mechanism.
Does hormone regulate through feedback mechanism? Demi Lola?
No.
See, I have been telling this. If you don't understand thing, if you don't memorize only if you don't understand, if you don't put into use, it is useless. I have been telling you insulin, CAMP. Don't you understand this? What does insulin CAMP means? Protein phosphatase means dephosphorylation. Haven't I been telling you? Demi Lola?
You have.
Haven't I been telling you?
Yes, you have, sir.
See, that is what. So, glucagon means CAMP. And then what? Protein kinase A, that is, don't forget everything. It seems that you have forgotten everything, what I taught in you in MD1.
I thought you said insulin inhibits
glycolysis. I'm not telling you No, I am not telling you only. I am telling you all people. Don't forget that.
Yeah, I know, but at least today you said insulin inhibits glycogenolysis.
In insulin, see, same. The two hormones are, only these two hormones are regulating all pathways.
Okay.
Even gluconeogenesis, glycolysis, whenever we talk about these two hormones, these two hormones regulates all pathways.
Okay.
And actually, I have told you this. Weight condition is regulated by insulin. What does it mean? All pathway that happens during weight condition will work with insulin. Yes, all pathway that happens during fasting condition will work with glucagon. So during fasting condition, whatever pathway, this gluconeogenesis is also a pathway happens during fasting condition. Glycogenolysis also happens during fasting condition. So both will happen with glucagon. The phosphorylation. So this is the simple understanding. So hormone, how does hormone regulate body, Divya? Through which process? Divya?
Yes, sir.
By which process does hormone regulate are in the pathway?
I don't remember, sir.
See, that's very disappointing. That's very disappointing. I told you everything, but you say that means you were doing something else. That simply means logically, if you see.
I don't know what to think
in the class.
I know the process that it does. I do remember the insulin and glucagon process, that glucagon increases CAM and it activates protein kinase A, all of that stuff, but I don't know the name that I call.
Danny Lola, can you tell me how does hormone regulate pathway?
Through insulin and glucagon.
Through what process? Ultimately, what does happen? What do they do in
that?
Insulin and glucagon, the hormone. I tell hormone, that is means insulin and glucagon. Through insulin and hormone regulates enzyme through insulin and glucagon. It is not sensible. So hormone regulate enzymes by which process? This both insulin and
glucagon. Do you mean phosphorylation?
Yes, phosphorylation and
dephosphorylation.
Phosphorylation and dephosphorylation. And there is which mechanism? One is phosphorylation, dephosphorylation. Then second mechanism is? Three mechanisms through which enzymes are regulated.
Allosteric.
Yes, allosteric regulation.
Allosteric.
And third mechanism is? Induction and repression.
Yes, induction and repression.
So these three mechanisms, this is actually the core thing that is responsible for all pathway regulation. Now, so first let's talk about this. These are the activator. So I told you, high energy is activator for gluconeogenesis, but inhibitor of glycolysis. You can see high energy is activator of
gluconeogenesis.
And acetyl coenzyme A also represent high energy. It is also activator of gluconeogenesis. It activates which enzyme? Pyruvate carboxylase. I have told you the first enzyme of gluconeogenesis. Now, so opposite is the inhibitor. Low energy condition is inhibitor. So those which are lower energy condition, AMP and ADP are inhibitor, and activator are this. So inhibitor are second inhibitor is this fructose 2,6 bisphosphate. Do you remember this molecule?
Yes, sir.
It was activator for which pathway? Glycolysis. Because very, it is equivalent to glucose. So it is inhibitor for gluconeogenesis. You can see.
Gluconeogenesis.
Yes, you can see. Now, gluconeogenesis, you can see gluconeogenesis is activated by acetyl coenzyme.
Acetyl coenzyme, A and I energy.
And ATP. And ATP also activate this pathway. Now, inhibitors are ADP.
AMP, ADP, and fructose
2,6 bisphosphate. Can you see this all?
Yes, sir.
Fructose 2,6 bisphosphate inhibit this process. Conversion of fructose 1,6 bisphosphate to fructose 6 phosphate. Because this 2,6 bisphosphate stimulates this process, we have seen in glycolysis. And low energy inhibit this gluconeogenesis, here low energy activate. So we have compared this glycolysis and gluconeogenesis. That is why the same thing that is activating gluconeogenesis is inhibiting glycolysis. That is why the same two process cannot happen together. If your cell has very high amount of glucose, very high amount of glucose, then gluconeogenesis cannot happen. If cell has very low amount of glucose and very high amount of ATP, then gluconeogenesis. So understand this. This both are mutually exclusive process, glycolysis and gluconeogenesis. So remember these two. Now the same thing came here. Do you remember this?
Yes, sir. Glycolysis.
So same picture. So this is a very, system, this enzyme is like pacemaker of this glycolysis and gluconeogenesis. So during fasting condition, you can, when fed condition, what will happen? Glucose is very high. So glucose has to convert into pyruvate. So glucose will convert into 2,6 bisphosphate, and this 2,6 bisphosphate will stimulate this conversion of glucose into pyruvate.
Thanks.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Now, during fed fasting condition, what will happen is glucose is very less. So this will not be high. This will convert into this. And that is why during fasting condition, this becomes very low. And if it becomes very low, because it is inhibitor of gluconeogenesis, it becomes very low, then gluconeogenesis will be facilitated during fasting condition. So this is the regulatory mechanism. During fed condition, under influence of insulin, it will convert into this. You can see this. So first, suppose you are in hungry state, you are in fasting condition, then what will happen? Glucagon will convert this enzyme, phosphorylate this enzyme, like this. And phosphorylated enzyme will become phosphatase. It will be phosphatase. It will convert this 2,6 into 1,6 phosphate. Now in fed condition, this will again be dephosphorylated. And this glucose 6, fructose 6 phosphate will convert into this. So this is not new thing. You go and read yourself. So this is, this mechanism actually is regulating both gluconeogenesis and glycolysis. Because gluconeogenesis and glycolysis, I told you, they are mutually exclusive processes. If there is high glucose, low ATP. High glucose, low ATP, what will happen? High glucose.
Glucose, low ATP, gluconeogenesis.
High glucose.
Oh, no, sorry. It's the other way around.
High glucose, then glycolysis.
Glycolysis.
Low glucose. And high
ATP.
Then
gluconeogenesis.
Gluconeogenesis. Remember, simple in a simple way. Then you can understand the detail of everything. So this is the thing I have already told you. So this is a two-headed enzyme. Now can you tell me this? Can you answer this question? The same type of question.
Absolutely.
That we did before. An individual with basal metabolic rate is 35 was advised by physician to eat less and exercise more. The patient took This implies an extreme and has not eaten for 48 hours. Means 2 days. Which of the following best describes the patient's activity? Phosphorylation state of the following enzymes, following key enzymes, phosphorylation of following key liver enzymes. Activity and phosphorylation. In fasting condition, in prolonged fasting condition. Just tell me.
Just gluconeogenesis.
So, how do you solve this question? First, segregate these enzymes into two conditions, fasting enzyme and fed enzyme. Which of the following is fed enzyme?
Glucokinase is fed.
Great.
Glucokinase
is fed. Good, Divya. And then, which is fasting enzyme?
Phosphofructokinase 1.
2.
This is fasting enzyme?
Phosphofructokinase 2.
No, it is phosphofructokinase 1, 2, both are fed enzyme. Phosphofructokinase 1, PFK1 is fed enzyme. And then pyruvate kinase is also fed enzyme. Did you see this?
Yes.
All are fed enzymes. There is no fat.
So
fed enzyme are active in which condition?
In glycolysis.
Insulin will cause all enzyme to dephosphorylate. So if any enzyme in fed condition is active, it will be active in dephosphorylated condition. So you can see. Now let me tell you, among these three enzymes, first stage is to classify between this, then you will understand which enzyme are phosphorylated and dephosphorylated. Then second step, I told you, find out which enzyme is not actively controlled by phosphorylation, dephosphorylation. So among these, which enzyme is not controlled by phosphorylation and dephosphorylation?
PFK.
PFK is not controlled by phosphorylation, dephosphorylation. Not controlled by phosphorylation, dephosphorylation. That's great. Then glucokinase is also not controlled by phosphorylation. Only pyruvate kinase is controlled by phosphorylation, dephosphorylation. Now, so there is no problem of phosphorylation. All will always stay in dephosphorylated condition. So there is no regulation with phosphorylation and dephosphorylation. These two enzymes. Let's talk about, they will be active in fasting condition. I told you that mechanism of activation is different. It is indirectly regulated by insulin to PFK2. If you can remember, indirectly regulated to PFK2 by synthesis of which fructose 2,6 bisphosphate. Indirectly. Now let's see this activity during fasting condition. Which is active? Is this active? Activity is high? Low. It is activity. Activity is low. But is it phosphorylated?
No.
No. These all enzymes will not be active in fasting condition because the hair condition is fasting. So all enzymes will be inactive. And all enzymes will be in phosphorylated condition. So they phosphorylate because this is not regulated with the phosphorylation, dephosphorylation. That is, that therefore, there is no chance of phosphorylation, dephosphorylation of this both. Only this will be phosphorylated, dephosphorylated. So low activity, yes, low activity. No phosphorylation, yes, agree, no phosphorylation. But if this is wrong, then whole answer is wrong. Now let's come to this B. So is phosphofructokinase activity high during this condition?
No.
No. Is high? No. Its activity is low. That is right. Then phosphorylated, non-phosphorylated? No phosphorylation. Let's come to this glucokinase. Just tell me, answer me. Activity of glucokinase during prolonged fasting condition is? Is it right? This? because it's a fasting condition, so activity will be low. Yes, low. Then phosphorylated, dephosphorylated. No phosphorylation because these are not related by phosphorylation, dephosphorylation.
It's B.
No phosphorylation. B, low. And is it phosphorylated? Yes, it is phosphor. It is regulated by phosphorylated, dephosphorylated. So that is why it will be phosphorylated at this condition, because fasting condition causes phosphorylation of all enzymes. So this is also not right answer. No, low activity, yes. No phosphorylation, correct. Low activity, yes. But phosphorylation, then this is also wrong. Low activity, yes. Phosphorylated, is it phosphorylated? No. Low activity, yes. Phosphorylation, no. So if it is, I am wrong, all are wrong. Now can you see low activity, phosphorylation, no phosphorylation. Low activity, yes. No phosphorylation. Low activity, but it is phosphorylation. So answer will be E. So this type of question takes time. If you understand the things really nicely, then you can answer. I will be giving one question from this type of question, at least. So can you see which of the following changes in enzyme activity will occur within 1 hour of a type 1 diabetic taking an injection of insulin? So that means insulin is there. This simple means insulin is there. This patient is taking insulin. So what will be the? So this condition is fed condition or fasting condition?
Fed condition.
This situation is fed condition. So which enzyme is active in this fed condition? Let's classify enzyme into fed and fasting. Which enzyme is fed?
AFK.
Which enzyme is fed enzyme among this?
Insulin. Oh, okay.
PFK1.
PFK1 is fed enzyme. And then other which enzyme is fed enzyme? Only two enzymes are there.
PFK2
is which enzyme fed or fasting?
PFK2 is 2.
What?
PFK2.
Yes, Bilal. PFK2 is also fed enzyme because it regulates it indirectly. Both are PFK1, PFK2, both are fed enzyme. Now, see, this glucose uptake means GLUT. So, GLUT is active, liver, muscle GLUT is active during fed condition. So this is also, it is muscle GLUT is active during which condition? Insulin. It is insulin dependent GLUT, muscle GLUT. So see, when it has taken insulin, which will be the answer now? Is this enzyme active?
Yes.
Is this enzyme active? Yes, it is active. Is this enzyme active?
Yes.
Yes, it will be active. The kinase will be active. And is this enzyme active? Is this transporter active? Yes, it is active.
Yes.
So A will be the answer. Did you get this?
Yes, sir.
So this is the end of class. Did you answer these questions? If you don't answer, let me revise this question because you have time. Did you understand these questions?
Yes, sir.
Can anyone guide me to answer this question? Can first. Anyone? Yes, Bilal.
So first,
Bilal is brave enough. Okay. Yes.
Phosphorylation.
First classify into, first step is classify enzyme into fed and fasting. Okay, first step. So These enzymes are there. Which are fed enzyme, which are fasting enzyme? Tell me. So you place this phosphofructokinase. Yeah. Where do I place?
Sure.
F. Okay. Okay. This is active in fed condition. I placed it here. Then glucokinase. Place it. Gluco. And then last enzyme is pyruvate kinase. So which enzyme among which enzyme is activated by phosphorylation, dephosphorylation?
PFK.
This is phosphorylated in fasting condition. And this enzyme in fasting condition, GK, glucokinase, it is not phosphorylated. PFK. PFK, is it phosphorylated? It is not phosphorylated. Both are not phosphorylated. But these are active in this condition? No. No. And this is also no. So if you can write like this, it will be easy. Now you can match this with this anyone. So which will match? During this is activities like this. Here activity is high. So this is which context? Fasting or fed context?
Fasting.
So now you can see this low. Yes, low. Is it phosphorylated? Is it phosphorylated?
Yes.
Is it phosphorylated? It's phosphofructokinase.
Fasting. Phosphorylation.
In fasting condition, some enzymes are not regulated by phosphorylation and dephosphorylation. So this PFK will not be regulated by phosphorylation and dephosphorylation. So there will not be phosphorylation. There will be, the answer will be no. So this is a wrong answer. So go and read. See, if you don't read, if you don't like take a bit headache, if you don't revise and what do I say? If you don't think over it, if you don't meditate upon something, concept, then you will not understand logical. Actually, I have told you everything, but if you don't, you try to meditate on these things, you will not understand. So focus on this all concept. If you have not, tell me if you have not understood anything by this time in whole chapter. It seems that you have understood everything. So this is very important concept. Pyruvate carboxylase, don't forget it. It is activated by acetyl coenzyme. This is also very important. These two steps are very important. Okay, and regulatory step here, this is very important regulatory step, conversion of this fructose 1,6 phosphate into fructose 6 phosphate, and glycolysis here you will see conversion of this, and this both are tightly regulated by fructose 2,6 bis phosphate. If concentration becomes high, this reaction will be stimulated. If concentration is low, then this reaction will be stimulated because this is inhibitor of gluconeogenesis. So remember this all fact. And try to actually recite and then revise and reflect. Okay, if you don't reflect on the concept, you will not understand.